How's it, everybody, and welcome to the Weekly Dose. I'm Brooks Baer. I work here in the Communications Department at the Department of Health, and I'm delighted to bring you our first ever edition of a new feature. We hope this is weekly because we are calling it the Weekly Dose. We're going to talk all things COVID and a whole lot of COVID vaccination news. We want to bring you up to date and bring you the very latest information regarding COVID-19 vaccines as we all fight this horrible pandemic. We'll be talking about some very exciting news today. We're going to be talking about a opening up of a brand new population of people who will be eligible for vaccines. We will be talking about a new vaccine product here in the islands to help us battle COVID-19. And we'll be talking about a cluster that has some people, if not concerned, certainly has our attention. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you all to our first guest here in the first ever Weekly Dose. Joining me now is Dr. Sarah Kemble. And Sarah Kemble, you probably recognize, is the acting state epidemiologist. She heads our disease outbreak and control division. Dr. Kemble, thanks so much for taking the time today.
Hello, Brooks. Thanks for having me.
I'm delighted. I get someone who, and those of you who don't know, she is in charge of the contact tracing, and she is at the pinnacle of this whole vaccination effort. So she is a wealth of knowledge, and she's someone I always run to when I need information. We're going to talk 70 and above as a new population who can be vaccinated in just a moment, and about the brand new Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is giving us a whole new tool against COVID-19. But first, let's talk about the cluster report just published. Interesting news in there regarding what some call the UK variant, but we call it the B.1.1.7 variant. There are now a total of 6 cases identified, all of them on Oahu.
That's correct. And this week's report describes the investigations performed around those cases. So we do investigate all cases of COVID-19, but when we see a variant case, we dig a little bit harder and a little bit deeper to find out what might be going on. These the six cases occurred in 2 households, one household with 2 people in it and the other with 4 people in it. The 4-person household, 2 of those were among children who actually attended a preschool. Now, this was concerning when we heard about it. They attended while potentially infectious, but we did further investigation and we ended up identifying 38 close contacts associated with the school. We got 35 of them ended up being tested and all tested negative, thankfully. That included 38 close contacts included 30 students and 8 teachers. So although this variant certainly has gained a reputation for being potentially more transmissible, what we were able to observe is in this classroom setting where the children and staff were wearing their masks, they were observing distancing, and they were doing good hygiene, we didn't see any transmission. And that's good news. It's what we've heard about these variants. They may be more transmissible in some settings, but it's the same set of guidance and mitigation measures that prevent it from spreading.
Yeah, what you just told me really kind of validates this whole thing about maintaining distance and wearing your masks. Seems if we follow those practices, we can protect ourselves pretty effectively from even the variants.
Yes, and especially in these settings with younger children, the distancing is a little hard. It's not an exact science, but the masking is really key. And we found that kids this age actually can learn how to wear a mask well. And when that's being observed in the classroom, you can still see breaks in transmission.
Okay, from the kids, let's talk a little bit about our kupuna. Up until this point, we have been really focused on vaccinating the 75 and above, along with the healthcare workers and people in our long-term care facilities and those frontline essential workers. But so many of us have really focused on our grandparents and the kupuna because they've been so at risk and so tragically impacted by COVID-19. So the threshold for vaccinations has been 75 and above. If you're 75 and older, we've been allowing you to register and go get vaccinated. But come Monday, anyone who is 70 and above can get vaccinated. How were we able to make this change? I mean, what was it that signaled that now is the time to lower that threshold to 70 and above?
That's right, Brooks. We've been moving through our vaccine phases and making sure we really get through our target populations that are at highest risk. And we've made good progress. So in looking at our progress over the last week and where we've come so far, it was apparent that we're ready to move on to the next phase. So we have vaccinated over 60% of our 75 and plus, probably a higher percentage because we have additional vaccines coming in through some of the federal programs. And we're also seeing that we have the capability with our appointment slots to move on to that next phase. You will still be able to get your shot if you were in phase 1A, 1B, if you're 75 and over. You're still able to come in and get your shot, but now we can open the doors to more people. And that's very exciting.
That is exciting. But what if I'm 69 years old? I mean, how much longer might I have to wait? Is it a matter of just keeping your eye on that, on the vaccination uptake and see how many people continue to register to be vaccinated?
That's right. And keep your eye on the website at COVID-19.com. The registration links are there and will be updated as new groups become eligible for vaccine. This coming week, it's going to be 70 and above. But as we continue to make progress and see more vaccines coming in, we can get through more doses and we will keep you posted when we're ready for that next group.
And something that has also happened in recent weeks is the introduction of vaccines to the CVS Longs, our Longs drug stores here in Hawaii. There are 10 Longs around the state. There's at least one in each county that is offering on-site vaccinations. And that has been to people who are 75 and above, but CVS Longs tells us that they're gonna lower that along with the rest of us here in the state of Hawaii to 70 and above come Monday. So that's pretty exciting news. And here's something else that's really exciting. I mean, I've been getting calls all day and inquiries all day about this. And actually I'm really surprised and delighted to know that so many people are interested in the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. That came to us, we got our first shipment this week.
Yes, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine got its EUA approval last weekend, and we now have the guidance from the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, and it's arrived in the state. So we have received 11,900 doses of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine this week. 5,900 doses are here on Oahu, and 2,000 doses have been shipped to each neighboring county as well.
What is it particularly about this vaccine that has you excited?
There's several things about the Johnson & Johnson that are exciting. One is that it's been approved for a single dose. So you don't have to come back in 3 to 4 weeks for that second dose. You get one dose and you're done. Another is that it doesn't require quite as much acrobatics around the transportation and storage because it doesn't need to be kept in the super cold freezer temperatures. This vaccine can be held at refrigerator temperatures, and that makes it easier logistically to deal with.
Okay, so it's easier to transport. Does that mean it might be moved to, you know, rural communities? I mean, it's probably easier to get there. I guess what I really want to ask is, where are you going to roll this out? Who's going to get it? When might that happen?
So right now, still because of allocation overall, it's going to be through the existing pods. Now, there might be some opportunities to stand up some new pods as it adds to our overall supply. Each county will be offering pod sites that are specific to Johnson & Johnson. So when you go to a particular pod, it's going to be one, typically it's going to be one kind of vaccine. But you can register ahead to see what kind of vaccine is going to be offered at that pod, and you can decide which one you want to go for.
Another question I have received from some of the people who have logged into our Facebook and sent messages, what population is this best for? Is there an age group that this is really designed for, or is it good for everyone?
So after reviewing all of the studies and the guidance that's coming out from CDC, this vaccine is being recommended for all ages, all groups. It's not a specific population. In looking at the data so far, it is an effective vaccine. It's very safe, and it does a particularly good job of preventing hospitalization and death, just like the other mRNA vaccines that are available so far. So no distinctions being made in terms of specific populations. So it's really more about, you know, preference for one or two dose regimen, and some of the side effect profiles. So this one seems to maybe be less likely to give you 2 days of aches and chills. So that might be appealing to some people.
All right, I want the J&J, or wait, no, maybe I want the Pfizer, or maybe I want the Moderna. Is there any opportunity for people to have a choice here?
Yeah, like I said, you won't be in the situation of going to a pod where you can pick, you know, one, two, or three there on the shelf. It's going to be offered at certain pods because you want to make sure that the people administering the vaccine know the right protocol for that vaccine. Each protocol is a little bit different, so it'll pretty much be pod specific, but you can look online or call ahead to the site and find out which vaccine is being offered and make your selection that way.
Well, I got to think this is only going to help us as we try to accelerate the vaccination process, and it's going to help.
What's so exciting about it is it means more vaccine coming into the state. The more vaccine we're able to offer and being able to get it done in one dose means moving through that more quickly. That's closer to herd immunity. And herd immunity is our goal. That's where we see enough people vaccinated that the overall transmission of the virus starts to drop off on its own.
Whether someone picks Johnson & Johnson, they pick the Moderna vaccine, or they get vaccinated with the two-regime Pfizer vaccine, after they're done getting vaccinated, what's it important for them to remember as they go forward, protect themselves, protect their loved ones, really protect all of Hawaii?
Yeah, even after being vaccinated at this time, it's still really important to maintain your masking, wearing a mask when in public, and your distancing and your staying home when sick. Those are all still important measures to be taking until we get to that point of herd immunity.
Dr. Campbell, I very much appreciate the time you've given us here today. Good information and some exciting news. I mean, we are now a year into the pandemic. But it seems we're really making some headway.
It does. You know, I think had you asked me a year ago if we would be actually getting shots in arms and through over 300,000 doses in the state, I would never have guessed it. It's really been impressive at how quickly the scientific community and the world has managed to mobilize around this and make these vaccines possible.
Well, to get 15 minutes of your time is a blessing to all of us. I know how very busy you are, and the demands on your time are incredible. So Dr. Sarah Campbell, our acting state epidemiologist, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us.
You're very welcome.
All right. And before we go, everybody, I would like to share some numbers and talk a little bit about what's going to be happening next week. We want to talk about the vaccine allotment that is coming next week. And here's your number. You're the first to get this number. 62,330 doses are expected to be delivered to Hawaii next week. That doesn't include anything that the Department of Defense might be getting. We don't know what those numbers are. They keep them to themselves, at least for the time being. So it's encouraging to know that even the numbers are greater than we actually know, because people who work on base, people who serve in the military, people with the VA, they're actually getting vaccinated, and we're not even including those numbers in our counts. So you take our counts and you think, ooh, there's a bonus number out there somewhere of people who are getting vaccinated through the Department of Defense. But we, as the state of Hawaii, will be getting 62,330 doses next week. Now, those are only the Pfizer and Moderna doses. We do not expect that next week we're going to get any Johnson & Johnson. That's because Johnson & Johnson had somewhere in the neighborhood of 4 million doses on the loading dock when they got that emergency use authorization, the okay to go ahead and ship those vaccines out. So they got those to us quickly. We got 11,900 doses of Johnson & Johnson this week, but all that stuff has left the loading dock. So Johnson & Johnson is now ramping up production. Probably won't get any J&J next week, but in subsequent weeks, we do expect to be getting shipments. So this week, including the 11,900 we got from J&J, we got 67,280 total doses. So next week, there's actually a reduction of like 5,000, almost 5,000 doses. But if you take out the bonus shipment we got this week at J&J, next week, we're getting more Pfizer and more Moderna as a regular allotted shipment than we've ever had. We continue to inch upward in the vaccination allotment scale. And so we're gonna be able to accelerate what we do in getting shots in arms to try to protect Hawaii. And that's really what the Department of Health is all about. We're working really hard to keep you healthy, and we're trying to save lives. And what you have all done, Hawaii, doing your part, wearing those masks, maintaining physical distance, avoiding crowds, and now waiting patiently while it's your turn to be vaccinated, those are the things that are going to help us. So thanks so much, Hawaii, for not only doing your part and being so patient through this difficult pandemic, but thanks for watching the very first edition of The Weekly Dose. I'm Brooks Baer for the Department of Health, and we hope we see you again soon. Aloha.